I'm Jaspal Sandhu. I'm the faculty lead for the Fung Fellowship, part of the teaching team, along with Mariella Herrick, and part of a broader team that includes Dr. Jennifer Mangold, our program director, and Adrian Greer and Ashley Villanueva, who are also joining us today. Up front, I'm just going to talk about the logistics and how the day is going to go. But first, I want to turn it over to Dr. Mangold to share some thoughts with you all. Jennifer.
Thank you, Jaspal. So we are really excited to share the work that our students have been diligently working on in some of the most amazing circumstances over the last semester. I think they're commitment, innovation, teamwork has been really outstanding and under the best of circumstances, which makes it even more impressive that they, you know, facing our current societal challenges and moving to remote learning, having to really upend our lives, I think makes it even more impressive of what they have been able to accomplish. As many of you know, the theme for the evening is Aging 360. So our population that our students focused on was older adults, and I think which made it even more challenging and more important, the work that they're doing. As we know that they're one of the most vulnerable populations for COVID-19. So they really stepped it up and were able to continue and press forward. And that's thanks to many of the supporters and partners and team that we have here tonight. And really the work that they focused on touches older adults and aging kind of the full life cycle. So really thinking from intergenerational mentors to aging in place, employment for older adults, the role of caregivers. So not just the older adults, but those in their care circles that they're focused on and a meaningful part of their life. And together the nine teams have really been working to address these many dimensions of aging. You know, I think it's kudos to them for being able to adapt to the situation. Also thanks to our partners, who we would not have been able to do it without the support and the projects that they brought to us. So we have CareMerge, Tin Can Associates, Osher Lifelong Learning at UC Berkeley, and SF Tech Council. They have also really been a tremendous support and able to pivot and support our teams and in this time as well, which we really, really appreciate. Also want to thanks to our honors fellows. They were mentors to our teams. Our graduate student instructor, as Jaspal mentioned, Mariella Herrick. Jaspal, our faculty, to really support and to move to this complete online learning situation. And Adrian Greer, our program manager. And as Jaspal mentioned, Ashley Villanueva, who really helped the marketing and setting up for the events and showcasing the great work that our students have done. So just wanting to acknowledge the agility that everyone has had, the support that we've had. It's really appreciative, and it's really a fun night to be able to celebrate all the hard work that the students have done. Thank you, Jaspal.
Thanks for that, Jennifer. Now I'm going to turn it over to Adrian.
Hi, all. As Jaspal introduced, my name is Adrian Greer. I'm the program manager for the Fung Fellowship. And as we're here tonight gathered for the final event, I also just really wanted to acknowledge the work that you all have done, the fellows, throughout the entire year. There's a lot to be proud of, well beyond the amazing deliverables I'm excited to see in a few minutes. But just want to acknowledge that our journey really began together in August 2019, which I don't know for you all, but for me, feels like a long time ago. We began with a challenge that was really focused on a campus service project. So working with UC Berkeley's Health Center, the Tang Center, looking at social connectedness on campus. Since then, these fellows have collectively completed a number of design challenges, interviewed hundreds of users as part of their user engagement, really grown as empathetic and resilient designers, and really formed friendships and professional connections that I have no doubt will extend well beyond your time at Berkeley. I'm really excited to see these presentations tonight, and also just thank you again for showcasing agility, tenacity, perseverance, and so much more during these past weeks, but also throughout the entire year. So excited for tonight.
Thanks, Adrian. As I promised, I'll keep my remarks short and to the maybe the operational aspects of tonight, because tonight's really about the students, the teams, their work, and our partners. This is a rough agenda. This is the sequence of things that we're going to cover over the next 2 hours. As Jennifer mentioned, we have four partners who are all here with us: Tin Can Associates, SF Tech Council, OSHA Lifelong Learning at Berkeley, and CareMerge. And we have nine teams, three that work with Tin Can Associates and two that work with the other three partners. There's only one thing that might look a little different with this. We've clustered the teams because it seems like a nice way to tell the story and for it to make sense to all of us, to the fellows, to the partners, and to the many guests that are here now and are going to be joining us in the next few minutes. One of the Tin Can Associates teams is going to be joining, or is going to be presenting at the very end, around 6:35. The reason for that is that Tin Can and CareMerge, one of the CareMerge teams, each have a team member in Asia, one in Taiwan and one in India. This has been quite unprecedented. As Jennifer said, we have people that are all over the place right now. And that includes our fellows. Normally we'd be doing this in person in an event at Berkeley at one of our lovely venues, and we're doing it on Zoom. And this is hopefully a way that we can still get access to the student work and still have a meaningful engagement with you all. One thing that's nice about this is that we think we can actually get even more diverse feedback than we would typically get in an in-person environment. So the format for tonight is going to be that each team is going to have 3 minutes to present. They'll be presenting from their own computers. Everybody's going to be doing their own screen share. And then they'll have 5 minutes for question and answer. And it might not seem like a lot of time. 3 minutes isn't really a lot of time to condense 10 weeks of work across a team of, three, four, five students and a partner, and dozens of interviews and so on. But this is something that we really train our fellows on and coach them on and work with them on. We really feel like the value is going to be in that Q&A piece. Given that there are so many of us, current count is 86 participants. The Q&A is going to be initiated by the partner organizations. They're going to be, just jump in, unmute yourselves, partners, when it's your team, and start asking questions, making comments, whatever it is. As we've communicated with all of you partners as well as fellows, this is not the last engagement. We're expecting that each of the teams is going to have a follow-up, just handoff call or conversation with you. But this is certainly an opportunity to ask some of those key questions. For the rest of you, and that's for our guests, our many guests, our honors fellows, our Fung Fellow alumni, our Fung Institute staff, even other fellows, we really strongly encourage you to ask questions or make comments in the chat box. You don't have to wait until the end of the presentation. It's certainly a way to encourage the teams, but it's also a really rich and important mechanism for providing feedback. So, if there is spare time and there are open questions in the chat box for a team, would love for the teams to be able to address those. But even if they're not, this is, this is all data that we're sharing back with the teams and with the partners afterwards. So those questions are just so, so important. I can't stress that enough. And I hope that a few of you will crack the ice, so to speak. So I think once a couple of comments and questions start flowing, other people will feel a lot more comfortable doing that. For the teams now, just a couple of kind of guidelines. I've already made all of you who are presenting, I think minus one person I'm waiting to sign in, co-hosts, so you'll be able to share your own screen. You're responsible for managing it. If anything happens, you can pass it off to one of your teammates, and we're the, Mariella and I and Adrian are the tech backup in case anything really goes wrong and you need us to drive your slides. Whoever's presenting should pin Mariella's video so you can see it as you're presenting. She'll be maintaining the time. She's got visual cues to let you know how much time you've got left in your 3 minutes and overall your 8 minutes. If you run a little bit over your 3 minutes, that's okay, but it's gonna cut into your Q&A time. We have to keep to a really tight 8 minute block to make sure we can get through everything in this 2 hours. So with that, I'm gonna stop screen sharing and we're gonna start with two of the Tin Can teams. Vanessa, I think you and your team are up.
Yes, okay, let me screen share. Okay, can everyone see that? Okay, cool. Okay. Hi, everyone. So our project partners were Tin Can Associates, where our primary goal was to help accommodate middle-aged adults transition into living independently and comfortably as older adults in their homes. We created UDesign, a platform where older adults can access resources and products tailored to their specific needs and control their own space and home design, all while gaining a sense of independence, comfort, and happiness throughout this process. Some focus points we want to emphasize about UDesign is the importance of creating a lively aesthetic to our website to deliver experience where we simultaneously destigmatize shopping for age and disabilities, as well as creating access for people of all socioeconomic backgrounds, and overall incorporating the universal design into our platform and the experience. For our user research, we used Facebook advertisements and a Google survey. We distributed the Facebook ads to three locations that have the most people within our targeted demographic. So adults transitioning to aging 45 to 65, along with caretakers related to our demographic and people within the aging population, so older than 65. And through these Facebook ads, we gained insight on consumer behavior, their digital activities, the device use time, and the location of our two selected demographics. Based on all this data, this has helped us make our platform more personal to our users. Alongside the Facebook ads, we incorporated a survey link in our website where users could give us feedback on our website's presentation and features. The responses we received have allowed us to further improve our prototype and also situate our design within a larger context. We realize there's a bigger social inequity that our target demographic is facing, and that's the need of affordable housing with accessible features. These two channels of feedback have expanded our project and our understanding of the needs of the aging population and home design. As a result, we've been able to redefine or refine our final prototype some more. So as you can see, our first prototype was a simple layout of how we want to structure our platform, whereas our final prototype is a more fleshed out mock-up website with more visuals, a section to explain who we are, our purpose, and most importantly, we included a filtering feature for our products where users can filter through recommended layouts, our products, and specify for which conditions they are looking for. And in designing amid a global pandemic, we realize the needs of our users is beyond the capacity of our product. Therefore, our group's call to action is a sustainable collaboration between designers, health professionals, architects, community advocacy groups, and policymakers towards affordable housing for the aging population. We realize that the products do not contain the whole answer, and while these problems are complex, they aren't impossible to solve. And overall, we hope that with UDesign, we can alleviate part of the stresses for our aging population. Thank you. We'll take any questions now.
Well, I will start off. Well, first of all, congratulations, team. We're really excited by the work that you did. And if you don't mind to page back to the way you did the social media engagement, I have some questions. So this is really amazing that you got so much interactions with people. And I was curious if you gain some insight that there's a certain segment that have most interest, you know, who's really concerned and interested in their home design and how they're going to live when they're older.
Yeah, so one thing that we saw was that the majority of people who engaged with their ads were women. Mm-hmm. And then also the majority of the people who engaged with our ads were people from California compared to Florida. We had chosen Florida as a location because we researched and saw that there was a lot of older adults there. So this just makes us think maybe older adults aren't often on Facebook or social media. So I think this did make us realize we should try a different marketing strategy.
Excellent. I don't
know if my group wants to add anything else.
We also realized that direct engagement was, we found that mostly when we reached out specifically to our own networks and even using like the connections where Leah and Jonathan sent like the survey to people, that was where we got the most feedback. So I think Facebook is good for initial engagement, but we really found like directly reaching out to people, we got the most feedback from that.
Excellent. John, do you want to ask a question?
Sure. I mean, first, I just want to congratulate the team for all the great work. It's really conducted in a professional, logical kind of design thinking kind of approach in a very difficult atmosphere. So I applaud everybody for that. I was actually just curious about kind of where you might go next. Now you've kind of got a website now, you've gotten feedback on the website. Is this a project that you might suggest, like if you had the opportunity to move forward with and to evolve the website further, would you do it? Would you not do it? How might you prioritize your efforts moving forward in terms of evolving the design and the feature set? Could anybody hear me?
Yeah, we could hear you. Maybe, you know, it's not, we know your students and this may not be something you would immediately want to do right now, but just we're interested in your sense of, did you feel it was an urgent issue to the people you were communicating with? Does it seem like somebody should do a business in this area?
I think it is a good idea to do business in this area. With the Google Form survey, what we got a lot of feedback on was like the actual looks of the website. And then also, basically, right now with everything going on with coronavirus, we found like the bigger issue is just being able to find affordable housing for older adults. But just since that's not something we can like tackle right on, I do think providing a platform where older adults can go to and make it accessible is important. And so moving forward, we would just implement like the feedback that we got on the surveys and just fleshing out the website some more. And then obviously we wouldn't be the ones to produce our own products. So just finding connections and like with other brands that do cater to older adults.
Great. But I'm hearing you say that affordability, it was definitely an issue of helping people figure out how to make affordable modifications to their homes or buy affordable products for their homes so it would help them live well. Thank you. That's great.
Thanks.
All right. Thanks, Vanessa and team. We'll move to the next team now. Also with Tin Can, Marwat, over to you.
Great. Can you guys hear me? Great. We can get started. So hello, everyone. My name is Marwat, and my team is Nicole, Fahad, Dorsa, and Caroline. And today, we're going to be presenting you guys a food platform called FoodConnection. So we kind of gathered a few research, user research, and we wanted to kind of personalize this to Mary. So Mary came in, we interviewed her, and we also did more in-person research where we found that she was having trouble with staying in touch with her cultural, as well as finding ethnic foods that not only meets her appetite, but also her health needs. And so overall, we found that the way that they use elder users get their food is through public transportation, whether it's through paratransit, community delivery services, such as Meals and Wheels, in grocery delivery services such as Amazon Fresh. And essentially, all in all those aspects, they were trying to really live independently as much as eating ethnic foods, having inexpensive and ones that need help.
Introducing FoodConnection, an online platform that connects approved home cooks with local elderly neighbors in order to satisfy their health and food preferences through homemade ethnic food dishes. Based on the differing needs and preferences of our two target groups, we designed two different platforms, a website for the elderly and an application on an iPhone for the home cooks. So how will this work? FoodConnection connects approved home cooks with their nearby elderly neighbors who are looking for homemade ethnic food that satisfies not only their health preferences, but also their desire for tasty foods from different cultures. After specifying which ethnic cuisines they prefer, users will be connected to cooks in their local area who are able to make fresh food from their desired cultural cuisine. Users can also designate if they have any health conditions that the chefs should be aware about before making their food. Users have the option to set up a one-time order or subscription-based meal plan, and can then designate who they would like to order their food from and when they would like it to be delivered.
Our app for home cooks lets our chefs indicate which dietary needs that they accommodate, post real-time updates for elders on what they'll be cooking, and use our calendar feature to organize their day's deliveries.
And so safety was a big concern for our platform, and part of our inspiration came from AB66. And so we designed a 5-step plan for a chef. So they'll sign up, they'll go through a series of background checks, we'll help them obtain their licenses with a specific county, go through a series of educational courses that will handle food safety, and a series of kitchen evaluation now that we're ready to cook.
Food Connections distinguishes itself from other food delivery platforms through two different channels, elders at home and home cooks. With Food Connections, elders are connected with affordable meals that meet their nutritional needs and have to spend less time worrying about cooking. For home cooks, they're able to establish long-term relationships with elders in their community and have flexible hours when it comes to cooking. And cooking at home allows them to have the financial opportunity to create a business at home.
Thank you.
Thank you guys, this is really excellent. One of the things that we talked about at one point during the course of your project was that you had seen that there were a couple of instances of organizations that did try to set up home cooking delivery services. They didn't have the aspect of health for older people. But what I can't remember is, what were some of the reasons that the other group stumbled? Because I love this idea so much, I want to see it happen.
Yeah, this is definitely something we talked about a lot. While home food delivery services are extremely popular, there's often these gaps that make it not as desirable or accessible for elderly at the moment. And the main things contributing to that, I would say, are number one, the fact that they don't cater to their specific health needs. So something that our platform will do is that if someone, let's say, has diabetes or something along the same lines, they're able to specify that when they sign up, and the chefs will be trained to make food for them that is still healthy for them, given their condition, but also tastes great. So that's the first thing I would say. And then the second thing that distinguishes us is the fact that we connect you to specific cultural cuisines. So while other food platforms, I would say, are more generic, we allow users to really specify which culture they would like to be getting home-cooked meals from, and we connect them to different chefs from that culture. So I would say those are the two things that we really focus on that make us different from other competitors.
Thank you. Great. John, do you want to add anything?
Yes, I need to unmute first. Another great job. I mean, so well thought through, and just finding the regulations that allow you guys to explore the space is super impressive. And doing an iPhone application as well as a website prototype, all awesome. Again, you know, my question is kind of like, a little bit more like, you guys have done some really great work here. How might we prototype this in real life? We talked a little bit about this, I think, in our last call. I'm just wondering if any more thought has gone into that. How might we push forward with this? Because it seems like something that would be wonderful to test in the real world.
So we actually had a meeting talking about this just a couple weeks ago. So I would say the two main steps you would take is first, we would want to pilot the program in one specific community. So starting out small, and we'd pick where to go based on just like the elderly population. And so like basically the demand of the elders and also how many like home cooks we would be able to get. So go somewhere more popular and like concentrated in terms of the population. So that would be first. And then second, I would say we would probably start out by just piloting with a few different cultural cuisines. So we wouldn't want to start out by offering like every single food from every single culture, because that wouldn't be realistic. We would probably start out by picking maybe three or four cultures that are more popular in that area and people have more of a desire to get food from. And we'd start out by doing that and then expand from there.
Just adding to that, I think also finding, like, narrowing down the location based on where AB626 have accommodated a few counties to actually allow for home cooks. So there are a few counties that are, you know, have registered to allow for this. And so we're kind of narrow down based on what's, you know, available.
That makes a lot of sense. There are a bunch of questions, by the way, in the chat.
Yeah, I think that they very much, I looked at the questions that you're on the right path, that since this law was passed, there are some counties that have already got people signed up. I mean, right now it would be very hard for home cooks to get an inspector to come out to their house and certify them. So to leverage the fact that some of the home cooks have already been certified and then see if they want this additional market would be a great focus. I think that you basically answered that question.
All right. Great. Thank you. Thanks, team. That was really great. And like John said, there's a whole flow of questions and comments going there. Some of that's positive affirmation and some of it's questions that I'm sure you have answers to, and hopefully some of it's questions that can spark additional thinking as you close out and also set up for these next steps. For everybody else, that's not the end of our Tin Can Associates work. We've got one more presentation coming in at the tail end of our 2 hours, but we're gonna shift right now to the two teams that worked with the SF Tech Council, starting with your team, Julia.
Hi, can you hear me? Awesome. Hi, everybody. My name is Lindsay, working with Julia, Christina, Paul, and Wajiha, and we'd like to share our program, Skills for Success. This is Rose. She is a 63-year-old resident of San Francisco who works as a receptionist. She earns what is considered low income, and with technology changing the workspace, she has found herself confused and lacking confidence in interacting with new digital aspects at the front desk. This brings us to our How Might We? How might we support community organizations seeking to provide training and mentorship to older adults facing basic technology-related challenges in their jobs? We developed a mentorship program with the objectives of improving digital education access for low-income older adults and building their confidence with these skills. To start off the program, Rose is paired with a mentor who she meets with one-on-one. She works with her to develop a personalized learning plan based on her needs, goals, and existing skills. From here, Rose will attend weekly group sessions at the computer lab. Groups will be created based on similar tech-related challenges. Sessions will consist of a video lesson to expose participants to online resources and a hands-on activity applying what they learned in the lesson. The purpose of a group setting is to foster an environment of peer-to-peer teaching and learning and to promote social connectedness. As part of our solution, we have synthesized all of our research into a toolkit. This toolkit describes our research methodology, components of existing digital literacy programs, insights on best practices, and recommendations for next steps for each stakeholder, and includes an in-depth outline of the mentorship program we envision. We felt that this toolkit was especially necessary in the light of the COVID pandemic, because we recognize that in-person classes may not be feasible at this time. Nonetheless, we wanted to share existing online resources that older adults and community organizations can take advantage of remotely. Rose is a low-income older adult living in SF, but she was able to access our mentorship program through a trusted community center in her neighborhood. Her relationship with her mentor and experience with peer collaboration has built confidence in asking questions and sharing her knowledge, and her regular exposure to technology through the program has helped her develop her digital skills. After 3 months of Skills for Success, Rose now has a connection with her mentor, her community, technology, and her own intuition. Thanks.
Thank you so much. My colleague Andrew Broderick and I are here, and we just really appreciate your work. One of the things that we know that was a challenge, probably for all the groups throughout the semester, was accessing clients or consumers to actually talk about these sorts of things. And I was wondering, now that you've come to the end of your project, do you feel that you had sufficient exposure or access to older adults as you were doing this?
I can answer that. I think that if we had more access to individual user interviews, our prototype might have looked a little bit different. It might have had more of a focus on specific pain points that our users were experiencing. But since we were, I guess we sort of pivoted to more looking at secondary sources and what other organizations were looking at, our solution, I guess, sort of turned toward structure, like the structure of the program, and also taking inspiration from existing resources, which there's so much of that online. So I think things would have looked different, and following the pandemic, it would be great if we could conduct more user interview, but that's not how our design process was focused.
Andrew.
Hi, Lindsay. This is Andrew here, Carla's colleague. Appreciate very much, you know, the thought and, you know, output that you've created here, especially the toolkit, because that's a great resource for many organizations, you know, to think about how they might adapt it, customize it to their various populations. So one of the impressions I had from your kind of research is a very human-centered approach to the training and support that older adults may need, both in terms of their mentor and being in a community center where they can, you know, meet peers and exchange, you know, some of their experiences and maybe learn about strategies that they might be able to adapt. So my question is, you know, now, like with COVID-19, do you kind of see opportunities to also kind of apply this in a more remote context where, you know, the individual might be still homebound, not able to go out, and still be looking for this essential need to have digital literacy training?
Yeah, I can jump in here. That's a great question. And as Lindsay alluded to earlier, the toolkit contains resources, free online resources for both mentors and facilitators of digital literacy programs, as well as folks, older adults, seniors who are looking to gain digital literacy skills of some sort. And we compiled a whole list. Unfortunately, for those who lack the very, very basic digital literacy skills or the physical infrastructure to access these technologies on their own, that is a barrier and one that we recognize and acknowledge. But we're hoping that by providing community organizations these resources, they can potentially distribute them to their community members.
Great, thank you.
Build off of that, to answer Adrian's question about what types of tech skills do older adults want to learn? We're thinking, and through our research, we found that just basic digital literacy, as far as like using Gmail and G Suite, is needed for this community. So, sorry, there's music playing in the background. So yeah, just building general tech literacy and teaching them terminology and vocab of that space.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Paul. And do you have any, you know, kind of goals yourselves in terms of how you might want to take this to the next level?
Yeah, sorry, I can answer that. So I think a lot of that is, I guess there are contingency plans embedded in our vision for what next steps might be. I think it would be great to get feedback from community organizations in San Francisco who have the physical space required for our mentorship program, but also organizations that have an interest in this space who work with older adults who need this kind of support. So it'd be great to hear their feedback and more details about how feasible our plan is. And I think in terms of prototyping, there are smaller scale prototypes that we could implement, especially since in Berkeley, we know we have a lot of organizations or clubs that train mentors, student mentors. And so that's that's a resource we could tap into as well. Okay, sorry, Mariela.
Okay, thank you, Lindsay.
That was perfect timing. Thanks to the whole team. And now we'll turn it over to Aaron's team. Also for everybody with SF Tech Council.
Hi, everyone. Our team worked with the SF Tech Council to design a tool that accurately measures the digital skills of older adults. One of these older adults is Layla. Layla is 60 years old and has lived in San Francisco for the past 20 years. She currently works as a bakery assistant at Boudin Bakery, and her job requires standing for hours. It has become painful and exhausting. She would like to transition to a desk job, but she needs more digital skills.
She visits the library to explore computer learning resources, and the library has her take an assessment to see which class is most appropriate for her. Layla is hesitant to even begin the assessment because of the overwhelming amount of information on the screen. She just doesn't know how to use a mouse, and she doesn't understand the meaning of all the little symbols on the screen. English is Layla's second language, so she doesn't completely understand all the questions, especially those with complicated computer jargon. After completing the assessment, Layla receives a daunting list of all the questions that she missed.
She shares this experience with a friend who recommends that she try the Tenderloin Tech Lab program. At the Tenderloin Tech Lab, Layla is asked to take a different assessment called Confidently Digital. It's a personalized digital literacy assessment for older adults. The coach helps her set up the program with her ideal font size and preferred language. Layla is also given the option to listen to the instructions instead of reading. The coach lets her know how to change her preferences at any time. She's able to choose where to start and is finally able to learn how to use a mouse. Each icon also has text that describes its function, so she's now able to understand all of the little symbols. The assessment includes a progress bar and words of encouragement to keep her motivated throughout, even when she feels like she doesn't know the answer to something.
Layla appreciates the questions related to her confidence and problem-solving skills as it bolsters her belief in her ability to learn these foreign technology skills. After completing the questionnaire, she is presented with a summary of her strengths and general areas for improvement. The coach receives a more detailed report with a checklist of skills and information about Layla's learning style and recommendations for how to best support her. Layla participates in a technology training workshop every week. After completing the program, she finds a job as a secretary at a doctor's office, where she schedules appointments and manages confidential patient information on the computer.
Layla is not alone in her experience. In fact, 40% of older adults in San Francisco do not have basic digital literacy skills. Every person's needs are different, and assessments should highlight these different strengths. Confidently Digital does exactly that by providing a holistic view and accessible directions to ensure older adults succeed professionally. Thank you.
Well, this is Andrew again here, Sana and team. That was excellent. You know, you had a really good assessment of the problem, understanding of, you know, how to approach it from a problem-solving perspective. And I really love what you laid out in terms of how a tool could be designed that's customized, but at the same time addressing a lot of the cultural competency and literacy issues that individuals may have. Did you find any such tool out there in your research, or is this one that you conceptually, you know, have come up with yourselves and the way you presented it today?
I could take this. So we took bits and pieces that inspired us from other assessments and other tools and other websites that were particularly accessible and particularly considerate of cultural needs and literacy needs and also accessibility needs. So there is not a tool out there currently that assesses digital skills in a way that's so accessible. Mm-hmm. And we think that this is a much better tool than what currently exists out there and what is currently used most frequently, which is the North Star assessment.
Mm-hmm. Well, great, great. And do you have plans to continue building on this research now in a way that you could build a prototype or, you know?
I think it would be great to be able to continue to do this research. One of the things that we are interested in is iterating on this design and figuring out exactly what questions are most effective and what kind of timing is best for seniors regarding their needs for understanding the questions and also understanding a little bit more about how to set up the environment for these seniors to work best.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Thank you.
This is Carla, and that was fabulous. You know, as you just mentioned in terms of the types of questions that were most valuable, do you have any sense from your research of some questions you would definitely add to this or that would be critical to asking even as you know, like at the beginning of such a program?
I can answer this one. Something that we included in this assessment were questions relating to the seniors' confidence levels and also their problem-solving abilities in ways that weren't explicitly connected to digital skills. Because in our background research, one thing we found that's like important for employability is the ability to stay confident and stay like positive and believe that they can continue to learn and continue to make progress. So we felt that measuring that in this assessment was really important and did, you know, was indicative of their future employability. And that's something that existing assessments don't include.
Mm-hmm. I just had one further question on that in terms of, you know, you're looking at people's confidence. Is that something that you're connected to the issue of fear? Because in a lot of the people that we've talked to, fear or terror has even been used. And is that your response to this issue?
I would say that yes, that's one of the reasons that we included questions about confidence, because that fear about computers in general and this fear of exploring them and interacting with them is so real, and trying to target and understand how important support will be during training is super key.
Definitely. And you know, I think like one our experience at the Tech Council also is in certain areas, you know, the need for literacy is becoming more critical, like in virtual care services. And, you know, there's a lot of need there in terms of how providers might be addressing, you know, the needs of their patient populations to be able to get online to see a physician, et cetera. Have you thought about any potential segments that you might focus on where the need is greater, you know, to help with digital literacy and getting online?
We're One of the sections that we're including is working on Medicaid and also food stamp sign up online. So we're considering other things as well.
Okay, great. Thanks. Thanks, Aaron, and thanks to the team. Very impressed.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, team. And thanks to both of you, Carla and Andrew, for bringing this work to us. We are going to now shift to two teams that worked with OSHA Lifelong Learning. And after hearing them present, we're going to take a 5-minute stretch break because we know it's a lot to be on Zoom for everybody for 2 hours. So that's something to look forward to. First up, we are going to have Anupam's team.
Awesome. Thanks, Jasbal. Let me just share screen really fast.
Hello, everyone. We are Team 6, and we worked with the OSHA Lifelong Learning Institute to create the OLLI at Berkeley Life Journey Mentorship Program. How might we form a program that fosters intergenerational relationships that lead to a sense of fulfillment and perspective gaining? This was our guiding how might we question that helped us begin our research process into creating this mentorship program. Our design has two primary users: UC Berkeley students who are interested in gaining guidance concerning big life decisions through intergenerational friendship, and members of OLLI, which is a learning institute for older adults who are interested in becoming friends and mentors for a UC Berkeley student.
We conducted two rounds of interviews with Berkeley undergraduates and OLLI members, along with several interviews with leaders of existing mentorship programs and a literature review surrounding intergenerational mentorship. Our key insights from our user interviews were to focus on personal development, organize regular in-person meetings, and foster a sense of community at all levels for both the mentors and mentees.
Yeah, when deciding what aspects we wanted to focus in on for this mentorship program, we synthesized 6 key features we thought were most important and most impactful, as noted on the slides. The most important feature we want to highlight is having a life journey that is personalized to fit a mentee's own needs, in addition to helping a mentee navigate through big life decisions.
This Venn diagram provides a broader overview of our proposed mentorship program. Student mentees are enrolled in a decal, which is a student-taught course for units at Berkeley, and have weekly discussions and reflections at the start of each class. OLLI mentors build their own separate community through monthly lunches, and our program intersects the two users through a matching process facilitated by coffee chats, weekly mentor-mentee meetings during the decal course time, and mini cluster meetings with 2 or 3 pairs throughout the semester.
Depicted are the steps taken by the mentor and mentee. The mentee application is for the decal course. The mentor application establishes the weekly time. The present time slot avoids scheduling hassles and ensures consistent meetings. Mentors and mentees will attend the first course to receive guidelines and an idea of the program trajectory. Mentors and mentees then split into specialized orientations. Next steps account for the pairing process. Mentees will read mentor bios and choose to engage in coffee chats with the mentors. 2 or 3 mentors will be met by mentees to mingle. Mentees will rank their final mentor preferences based on the coffee chats. Mentees will be paired to mentors to foster relationships.
Once the mentorship pairs have been made, we look forward toward a semester's worth of meetings to deepen the relationship between mentor and mentee. To facilitate the connection, we plan to have 6 to 7 weekly meetings on UC Berkeley campus or nearby cafes with suggested conversation topics surrounding personal development and life journey. Over the course of the semester, we have additional check-ins to see interspersed throughout the semester to see how both mentee and mentor are doing through the program. For the mentee, this includes weekly reflections and discussions during the decal, and for mentors, monthly lunches. At the end, to celebrate the semester's accomplishments and progress, we wrap up with a final semester banquet and begin focusing on continuing the program into the next semester, including encouraging mentees to continue building their mentorship connections and also selecting facilitators to continue the program. Thank you. So we're going to open up for questions, and Megan is currently adding a link of an example syllabus of the decal structure in the chat.
Thank you, team. Cheryl, or I believe you're on. It's we got 4 minutes for Q&A.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Okay, great. Congratulations to the team. It's been really great to be able to see the slide deck tonight. Thank you. So first off, I want to tell you that the OLLI members that you conducted phone interviews with were very impressed with the depth of the questions that you asked and your follow-up. They really enjoyed speaking with you, and they really enjoyed the opportunity to have some input to this. And the other thing I was sort of wondering is, one of your key features was to have a personalized program. And you did share with me the fact that you had a syllabus for the decal, which is great because decals do require a lot of logistical arrangements. Do you see any issues with having a personalized program and a syllabus that has a weekly subject matter?
Yeah, so actually the way we structured the decal was that the weekly subject matter were more of suggestions in case the mentor and mentee like weren't really sure what to talk about. But we do include some discussion of that the mentor and mentee are free to talk about whatever they'd like, but they have a chance to revert back to the content that we proposed.
Great, thank you. One of the things that I know you ran into, and a spoiler alert for everyone, the two teams have very similar solutions, which they arrived at independently, and I did not prompt either one of them about this or share. But what kinds of issues did you find when you were speaking with the students on what their concerns were about a mentorship?
Yeah, so some of the students that I spoke to raised concerns about maybe not having the most like updated information, and this was also in the mentorship, and this was also expressed through OLLI members too. They were a little bit nervous about not having the most up-to-date advice, for example. So this was one of the concerns, which kind of led us to having a more personalized life journey focus. So while the mentor might not have the exact same path as the mentee, they still have so much general life advice to give, and they have so much exposure to different fields that they'd be able to help this mentee throughout their process in college. And this was something that the college students expressed a lot of interest in.
So the incentive to join this is essentially the decal and the fact that a student gets a credit for this.
Yeah, also additionally, with the student needs, they were worried about accountability and actually having structured meeting times. So the decal course was created in order to assure that structure for them, mm-hmm. and allow them to have a preset time where they could have consistent meetings with those OLLI members and continue building their relationship through that set time through the course.
Great. I think that having this amount of structure in there is a great initial approach to this and provides a lot of opportunity for this to really happen. Thank you, team.
All right. Thanks for that wonderful presentation. And Cheryl, you gave us a bit of a preview of the next team, but let's see what they've got. And Seike, we're going to turn it over to you and your team.
Okay. Awesome. All right, like they say, great minds do think alike. So so we're Team 7, a part of OLLI, and basically what I've noticed is that every year, hundreds of thousands of college graduates graduate without a job. And some of these people are our friends and our family. So we inevitably feel their feelings of failure and embarrassment. But the problem is that it's not with the students, it's with universities, because they don't put into their curriculum getting jobs. So at the Fung Fellows Institute, with the Fung Fellows, we partner with OLLI, And OLLI is a group of older adults who love learning and love coaching. So we decided to bring our collective expertise and make up a professional mentorship program. To this end, we answered the question of how might we engage older adults and college students in a mutually beneficial professional mentorship program? And based on our user studies and our user research, we found that overwhelmingly, the mentors and the mentees wanted in-person contact. They wanted like a personal connection. Above that, they wanted to be compatible with their mentors and their mentees. But one problem that we kept on running into is that how do you incentivize Berkeley students? Because when it comes to professional development, it's often like an afterthought. So how do we put that on their forefront of their brain? The answer was a decal. The decal meets the students where they're at because we're students and we're in the mindset of going to class. So we can offer them units, it's structured, it's easy to start and it's easy to pass on to the next generation. And also, simply, we can leverage universities' existing resources. So here's our process, a three-step process. First, we're gonna go recruit the students and we're gonna recruit them with the intent of giving them professional development. And then we're gonna ask them and gather information on their personality traits and just their professional goals and what's the trajectory of their career. Second, we're gonna match those students with mentors. Based on the algorithm we develop, it takes in consideration the profession the person has and their personality traits and pair mentees and mentors together. Lastly, we're gonna have a weekly meeting in class and a bi-weekly meeting with their respective mentors. We find this an effective strategy because we can hold accountable and make sure the mentors and the mentees are mutually both getting something out of this. Last, this is our wireframe. We came up with a website where the mentors and the mentees can work out the logistics of when they're gonna meet, how they're gonna meet. Also, we'll be consistently posting new workshops of what's going on. And if there's a new student out there that wanna join our particular decal, they can find information here. We strongly feel that with this decal and this mentorship, we're gonna do our part in alleviating recent college unemployment. Thank you very much, Mr. Artain.
Thanks, Sensei K and team. Over to you, Cheryl.
Okay, again, team, congratulations. Again, the OLLI members who you interviewed doing phone interviews during this incredibly challenging period were very, very impressed with the questions that you asked and the idea that you had of asking them if there might be mutually beneficial coaching going on. Like, would they like to coach undergraduates and would they like the undergraduates to coach them? And I think that you incorporated that, which was wonderful, so that there is some benefit on both sides and a give and take on both sides. I also think that the flexibility that you put into this and the matching process you put into this are truly outstanding. I'm very interested in the portal. I asked a bunch of questions about it the other night, and if you could just explain a little bit more about your thought about the portal and how it works, that would be great.
Yeah, so I can take this question. The idea behind the portal is we wanted to create a virtual place where mentors and mentees can maybe extend their relationship beyond just the classroom and the decal. So there's the opportunity to schedule Google Hangouts or like a Zoom call. There's also the opportunities to message directly to your mentor, to access past education, past workshops and such. So basically we wanted to bring, I guess, the decal into the virtual realm and really give mentors and mentees alike the opportunity to carry this outside of the classroom, I guess.
That's great. One of our original challenges was to find a virtual way to do this. And I think you melded the key findings that people really wanted one-on-one personal relationships And yet this portal provides a virtual way to connect and communicate. So that's fabulous. Any particular challenges that you felt you ran into that you didn't expect? None. That's good.
I think we can take this question for us. So I guess if there was anything, we kept running into that issue of incentive, just because when we interviewed students, they had expressed like concern with something like tangible coming out of this like program. And so our solution was, this was also addressed in the chat box, but what we plan to do is leverage like the connections that OLLI members have and provide some sort of like internship fair or career fair that only like students in the decal can like access or to like attend. And then that way they leave this decal program with something like concrete or tangible. And like that can be like a measure of like success for the student as well as the mentor.
That's great. And I like the idea that you left an opportunity to have a longer term relationship if the mentor and the mentee want to continue the sort of life professional coaching relationship through that portal. I congratulate you again. I'm really impressed with the program.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, team, and thanks to you, Cheryl and OLLI, for bringing that to us. We're excited to see what comes of it. So we've got three teams to go. As promised, we're going to take a 5-minute stretch break. Keep an eye on your own clock. I encourage you to actually stand up and walk around, except for you and Seike, because you already did that. During the break, we're going to also play a slideshow that it's for the fellows, but it's for all of you. It's got some photos and some memories from the last year of this fellowship. A lot of it focused on the time that we were together in person. And big thanks to Adrian for curating this set of photographs. So we'll see you back in 5. We will start back up in just about a minute. Okay, so we are gonna get back into it. We've got two presentations coming up from teams that partnered with CareMerge, and we're gonna start with Anderson's team.
Okay, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Meet John, an 87-year-old man who moved into an assisted living facility 2 years ago after being diagnosed with dementia. Last year, John suffered a major fall, breaking several bones. His caregiver was luckily nearby and quickly got him to help. John isn't alone. Of the 1.6 million residents in U.S. nursing facilities, approximately 50% suffer from falls every year. A couple of months later, John was eating a meal in the dining hall when he began choking on his food, a symptom more common in dementia patients. Since he was in a common space, his friends quickly noticed and called facility staff members. In March 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic forced all care facilities into quarantine. Residents like John have been forced to spend more time in their rooms, eating meals alone and heightening the risk of undetected falls and symptoms like choking and coughing. One day, John starts coughing more than usual. Thankfully, he has a guardio to watch over him.
Hello, John. I noticed you are coughing more than usual. Would you like me to inform the facility staff?
The how might we question our solution aims to answer is, how might we utilize auditory data from CareMerge's Amazon Alexas to detect and act on hazards to seniors' health and well-being? The flowchart below details the steps Alexa takes to get a senior help. First, Alexa uses machine learning to identify sounds. Second, it determines if the sounds are worrying or out of the ordinary. Next, it first asks the senior if they need help from staff. And finally, if there's no reply, Alexa will contact the facility staff. For the prototype shown, our team implemented the naive Bayes algorithm in Python to detect coughs. We additionally looked into the numerous research studies on this subject and realized how this technology can be used even further to distinguish types of coughs.
We interviewed assisted living facility residents, administrators, and geriatric specialists to gain insight on the biggest challenges they face. We learned that safety hazards, understaffing, and privacy are three main issues which can all be addressed with Guardio. Privacy matters a lot to seniors, but it comes less of a concern to seniors when a tool has features and benefits beyond just ensuring safety. Beyond the COVID-19 pandemic, we will use technology as a tool to access human support, improving the standard of care in facilities worldwide. Our tool will assure older adults that help is accessible even if no attendant is in the room. It can also be used for fall detection and to help residents start calls to loved ones without waiting for a staff member to help them. These functions can be built into Alexas everywhere, even beyond care facilities.
Great, congratulations team for putting this together. I really appreciate the collaboration that you guys did and attention to details. I have one question. You got the opportunity to meet with older adults that are living in their apartments as well as in senior living communities. Do you feel both of them share same types of challenges, or were they very different?
I can answer that. As it happened, most of the people that we talked to incidentally lived in independent living facilities. And so to kind of make up for that difference, we spoke with a lot of administrators and physicians. Actually, I think Dr. Kalmar is on the call here, one of the doctors whom we talked to, and to kind of get a broader picture. And so while there are differences in needs, and it's like very bad of us to homogenize an entire group like that, we decided to narrow in on users who might need more of a safety help.
Great. And the other question I have is that you talked about Alexa, and I saw that the questions that you put together, technology was part of your survey and your interviews. Were you surprised by the feedback that you received from these conversations, that they are so comfortable with Alexa and other latest technologies? Did that surprise you?
Go for it.
Yeah, I'll just jump in here. I, for one, was a little bit surprised. It seems that the elderly generation is much more comfortable with technology in general than a lot of people think. One of the user research protocols that we did is we went onto Reddit, which is an online website, and we asked a question on a forum, and we got a bunch of super in-depth answers about the opinions of these people towards technology and towards new technology. And as Fahad, I think you pointed this out, that requires people to be logging onto their computers, to be going to this website, and then to be answering this question. And so in general, the target audience was much more comfortable with technology in general, and specifically with Alexas.
Great. So if you have to pursue this project as an older adult living in a senior living community, what is my undertaking? How much do I need to learn technology to be able to sign up for this product?
I think that the technology needed by the senior themselves isn't very high, as the detection is happening in the background while they go along with like their daily lives. So it's kind of just an extra tool to detect certain health issues that they might be going through and to help notify the senior staff. We also looked into one thing that senior staff and seniors brought up is that they want an easy way to call loved ones without using something like Zoom. So they wanted kind of a voice platform where they could just ask to talk to their sister or their brother or their children. So that's a thing that you would have to teach the seniors, but it would be an easy thing if there's a voice platform where they can just ask a simple question to Alexa.
Great. That's all the questions I have. Great job, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks. You actually have about 1 minute left if you want to poach one of the questions off the chat. You're also welcome to pass it forward. These are also questions you can address.
We have one question from Sana, and she's talking about false alarms. So if you have this device and hundreds of them in a senior assisted living community, and nurses are waiting for alarms and alerts, what if there are so many false alarms? And they still have to go into the apartment and address them?
I think for the algorithms and this technology to be deployable, there has to be a very few percentage of false alarms. And I think you can get that technology to that stage. Another idea I had was actually implementing, so if you know a senior is more prone to falls, you could put them on like a fall list of seniors who are more inclined or who may fall more often. And so the algorithm can be more sensitive for those cases while being less sensitive to other people.
And just to add on to that really fast, as you can see here from the journey map that is in our appendix, because we couldn't fit it into the 3-minute presentation time slot, at the end here, it Alexa detects trouble and it asks John if he's okay. And so he responds, it was just a book falling, not me. And so there's definitely an interaction between the Alexa and the individual user. And so from that interaction, Alexa can also learn even more what sounds are actually trouble versus what would be false alarms.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, team.
Good job, guys.
Next up, we have Tiffany's team, also with CareMerge.
Hi, I'm Carlos.
And I'm Tiffany.
And on behalf of Team 9, we will be presenting our team's prototype solution. For this design challenge, we partnered with CareMerge. CareMerge is a private venture that focuses on creating a complete mobile and web communication and point of care for seniors in assisted living communities. Recently, they have been working with Amazon Alexa as one of their core technologies to bring to seniors. Our goal was to better understand how smart technologies such as Amazon Alexa could better serve older adults and help facilitate care coordination and engagements. Our team worked to build off of Amazon Alexa's current capabilities to create a personalized platform that supports older adults and leading lives with a greater independence. During our customer discovery phase, after talking to seniors in living assisted homes, activities directors, we found that the priority for adults when it came to independence was leading healthier lives. And when it comes to improving the spaces that they live in, many would like a lot more staff around and a more personalized care. With this in mind, we wanted to incorporate three key elements: convenience, user-friendliness, and simplicity into our design. We aimed at an interface that was easy to use for seniors on a daily basis.
With this in mind, we developed Care Assist, an enhanced version of the smart speaker Amazon Alexa. Care Assist is designed to conduct weekly health screenings and schedule healthcare appointments for seniors living in assisted living facilities. Care Assist monitors elderly health through check-ins that are delivered by nurses and healthcare workers, and they're implemented through the Amazon smart speaker. Here's a demo of how Care Assist works.
Hello, John. You have an incoming check-in from your nurse, Nicole. Would you like to accept the call?
Hi, Alexa. Please accept the call.
Hi, John. It's Nicole, your nurse. How do you feel today? Are you happy, medium, or not doing well?
Today, I'm feeling happy. This morning, I went and took a little walk around the garden, and it was nice to get some fresh air.
How is your physical health? Do you feel like you're sick? If so, what are your symptoms?
I'm feeling better today. The pain in my right knee is going away. I think the physical therapy is really helping.
Have you been keeping up with your medications?
Yes, I'm still taking my medications at 9 a.m. I think my Alexa reminders are really helping.
How do you like your current living situation? Do you feel like you're making lots of friends or improving your independence?
I enjoy having people around. I like that I know how to control the music and the news on my own now.
So the user's responses are then transcribed into an electronic health record where care providers are able to keep track of the health of their residents. These health records can also be accessed by the residents themselves or by family members of the residents. Care Assist can also schedule healthcare appointments and schedule rideshare apps to deliver residents to their healthcare providers. This would also be accomplished through the Alexa smart speaker, in which a resident would simply ask Alexa to schedule an appointment on a certain day, and Alexa would get that done. Through Care Assist, in the future, we would want to program Alexa to have free-flowing conversations with residents in order for the smart speaker to interact with residents and facility staff in a more human manner. And through Care Assist, we hope to leverage Amazon Alexa as a tool for promoting health, social activity, and independence among the elderly in assisted living care. And that's the end of our presentation, and we'll dedicate the rest of the time to answering any questions.
Great, thank you so much. Great presentation, guys. So I have my first question is about privacy. as it appears that Care Assist will be able to wake up the Alexa device and ask a question or check in on the residents. When talking to older adults or residents, were they okay with Alexa just waking up in the middle of the day and asking questions?
So I can answer this. Our team recognizes that privacy will continue to be at the forefront of ethical concerns in any kind of technology that involves any sort of data collection. So we recognize that this is a very valid concern to have, and we would want to implement mechanisms in place to ensure that this data would only be accessed through the people who are supposed to access that data. So only through the healthcare workers who are working in the facilities, only through residents themselves, and also the family members of those residents. And we would want to create a procedure that would help ensure that privacy. But yeah, we recognize that that is definitely a concern to have, and that we would actively work with the facilities to make sure that that would be addressed.
Also to add on with that, we also made sure that whenever this would be implemented, that it would be an opt-in system. And since it's an electronic health record, it would also be covered under HIPAA. So there would be privacy attached to patient confidentiality as well.
Great. During your interviews with older adults, I saw the questions that you put together, very detailed. Were there any things that you heard or found that surprised you?
So I think that one thing that, I guess it didn't surprise me, but I guess I didn't expect, was that one of the questions that we asked was about the current priorities that seniors have at this time. And overwhelmingly, the responses was staying healthy and staying alive, and that I understand that, but I guess I was kind of surprised by how overwhelmingly those responses were. And one of the interviewees I had said something to me that really resonated with me that I'll share with you. She said that for older adults, unlike other age demographics, older adults aren't as concerned about the future, because for them they've already lived their life and they've seen everything. It's more of now just being comfortable and living every day and enjoying the present. And that was wow, that definitely made me rethink a lot of things.
Yeah. Okay, now in order to make this available, let's talk about your go-to market. Will you be selling this technology to residents directly, or will you be selling it to the communities and ask them to deploy, or both?
I think we created this product with the intention of focusing on assisted living facilities. So we would actually want to first implement this in senior homes and senior living communities first. And I think based off of that, if there is a general interest in it, and we iterate it further to make it more catered to individual needs, we would definitely be interested in opening it up to the market, because there is definitely a market for this.
Great. Again, thank you so much. A great presentation, and thanks for all the work that you guys did during this program.
Thank you to the team, and also to you, Fahad, for working with these teams over the past 10 weeks. We're excited to see the results. We've got one team left and a few closing remarks after that. Anna, and for everybody, it's a reminder, this is a team that worked with Tin Can Associates. You heard from two teams that partnered with Tin Can at the top of the first hour.
Hi, quick sound check. Can you hear me?
Yep, we can hear you.
Great, thank you. Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is David. Our team is myself, Neha, Taylor, Anna, and Iris. When we were presented with this design challenge, we were living in a very different world than the one we occupy today. The bonds of family and friendship that were once so easily accessible to us have been challenged. The spread of COVID-19 has changed the way we communicate and interact with one another forever. But loneliness is nothing new to our society. A study done in 2012 shows that isolation not only worsens mental health, but also exacerbates pre-existing health conditions. The world we know has changed, but the problems we faced before are still just as relevant. When talking to older adults, we heard this quote, which inspired the direction we took with this challenge. You know, life can get really hard and overwhelming sometimes. It's rare that we get moments to play and just be a kid, but I think we should all play a little more, don't you? And so with these changes to our daily lives, we dare to ask, how might we help aging adults remain in the comfort of their home while they keep and strengthen their social connections? Our goal at Living Room is to provide users with the ability to connect and have fun with family and friends as if all together in their own living room. We conducted research mainly through two methods, a Google Form survey and over 10 phone interviews. One big idea we took away from our interviews with older adults was the desire to return to normalcy, the desire and emotional need to engage in the activities that used to provide them with meaning and social connection.
Our quantitative analysis provided us with some clear data on our target audience and usability. We surveyed over 70 people ranging from children to older adults, asking them questions ranging from the type of platforms they use to how they spend their time. Based on this research, our team stumbled upon some initial concerns regarding a gaming platform. Many older adults found it difficult to work with new and complex technologies. Some had reservations with games, and some found it difficult to connect with the younger members of their family. Taking our user research into consideration, we created Living Room. Living Room has four main features that stand out in the gaming market today. Users can filter through games, schedule game times with friends and family, send out group invitation links, and use chat or video while using our platform. Living Room boasts a wide variety of games and activities for all interests, from traditional games like Mahjong, chess, and bridge, to more modern activities like Zumba or group painting. Users will be able to select their availability in an easy-to-use calendar, and Living Room will automatically generate an ideal time for the group to meet. With a host-based invitation system, participants can simply click the link and play. Here at Living Room, we aspire to connect friends and family with ease, simplicity, and comfort, and most of all, to play. We'd like to thank our mentors and especially our partners, Tin Can Associates. We couldn't do this without your support.
Well, John and I want to thank you guys. This has really been fun as the goal of the project, and we're very impressed. I am wondering, when you were doing the interviews, if you had a sense of how to overcome the fact that some of the seniors wouldn't be super comfortable with adopting a new online application, a new platform. What are some ways around that?
I can take this one. So I think what we found during our interviews was, while some folks did have concerns, once we explained that it would be relatively easy for them to use technology, given that many of them already use email or use video chatting applications, a lot of them found that this is something that they can integrate. So just to go back to it, the important thing about Living Room is that a host creates the game and then they just send out a link. So it's very easy for someone to just click on the link and join the game.
Excellent. John, do you want to add something?
Sure. First of all, I love the name that you guys came up with. I just think it's simple and it just says so much about comfort and being in your home and connecting with people you care about and you love. So kind of just want to give you a shout out for that. And I also think there is a tremendous opportunity. I've just seen it in my own aging parents who actually do spend a lot of time playing games, but they're often playing games by themselves. They're playing solitaire, or they're playing Scrabble or what have you, but against the computer. And yet, while it satisfies them for the moment, it actually increases their sense of isolation and loneliness. So I just think this is a great place to explore, and I think there's a real a need here, and it really kind of taps into some basic desires around entertainment and connection. And so applaud you guys for focusing and landing on this. I wanted to ask you guys though about kind of the competition and what you found, and are there platforms already out there that kind of do a lot of this, or individual games that do a lot of what you're trying to do. And maybe you can talk a little bit more about, you know, how this might line up against those potential competitors and how this might be differentiated.
Yeah, definitely. Actually, that was one of the largest things that we did in the beginning of our whole research component, was identifying market research. And Anna's pulling up the slide. We actually didn't include it because of our tight 3-minute component, but there are a lot of different platforms. I think it was mentioned in the chat that Game Pigeon is one of them. The main thing that we were focusing on was creating a platform that was easy to use. And a lot of these platforms are not as intuitive as they might be for older adults. For example, Game Pigeon is used only over iOS texting or different types of text messages, which is not always a super accessible platform, especially as devices are usually small. And as you grow older, your eyesight also starts to get a little bit worse. So those are some of the things we considered. I believe that one of our main competitors that we were considering was Jackbox, which is a digital gaming platform. One of the complications with Jackbox is that it is a subscription-based platform, so you can't access any games for free. And it also requires a separate form of video communication. And that's one of the things we realized, is a lot of these things don't have an integrated platform where you can do multiple things at once, where everything is somewhat scattered, I guess. So that's one main component to our application.
Nice. What about moving forward for you guys? I mean, what would you see as some of the biggest challenges in kind of advancing this concept? And how might you prioritize your efforts moving forward? That's kind of a challenging question, but.
So one of the biggest things that moving forward that would probably be the most difficult would to integrate the video chat aspect of it. Video chat, it's a pretty difficult technology to do really well, as we can all see. And so that would probably be one of the biggest hurdles to doing this.
How important is a video chat, by the way?
Well, we wanted to, of course, video chat isn't like mandatory. You can always turn the feature off if you don't want to be shown, which was something that some of our interviewees expressed wanting. And so we wanted video chat to make it feel more personable, and so that when you're playing games and doing activities with your friends and family, you can see them, and that mimics as closely as possible to actually doing it in person.
Can I jump in really quick?
Mm-hmm. Go for it.
In our interviews, we actually talked to a lot of folks, and part of the reason that this idea even came about was that folks said that they were having video chats with the younger people in their family, but those video chats would eventually kind of peter out because they ran out of things to talk about. So the idea really is to like have the games be a connection, but also being able to see your loved ones is huge.
Nice. So how might you prototype this idea? Like in a kind of inexpensive, timely fashion?
Sorry, yeah, I can take this question. I think the UI and the basic sense of the website would not be so difficult to create. It's more of kind of just alluding to what David already mentioned, is creating the video platform. There are problems with Zoom already, as you can see, and it's a very well-developed problem. So kind of going through those aspects and making a simple-to-use video platform but integrate it into a web platform would also be a main difficulty. The scheduling platform is nothing different from WentToMeet, which is already an existing platform. So taking some of their source code would obviously be one of the fastest ways, I guess, to get to a working platform that would be in market.
Well, thank you guys. Great job.
Yeah, this is great. Do you guys think you're going to be able to explore this further? Or
I'm sorry. They're super over time. So sorry.
Oh, so sorry. Sorry, Jasper.
That's all right. Thanks. Thanks to the team, and thanks.
Yeah,
to
you. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, obviously a lot more to talk about, and really a great way to wrap up. Thanks to the team, and thanks to y'all at Tin Can for also letting us split your teams across the 2 hours. I know that meant that you were on for the whole time, but I'm sure it was worth hearing all the presentations.
Totally.
Just to wrap, I want to turn it over to first to Mariella, then Jennifer, and then I'll have a few words, and then we can wrap for the evening. Mariella.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mariella. I am the GSI for this course, the graduate student instructor. And I just want to say that it's been an honor to work with you all, Fung Fellows. I think each and every one of you has impacted me in different ways. I've loved our time together in the classroom, running into you all on campus and being stopped to sit at random benches with you all, having coffee with you all, and office hours. It's been really fun to get to know each one of you. And I think that each one of you inspired me every day to be a better presenter, to be a better person, to show up. I know Tuesdays were really hard for all of us because we had class from 5 to 7. And then after that, there was a few of us who had class again from 7 to 8. And even though it was a long day for me and for you all, I always felt rejuvenated after that. So I would like have to go to the gym or do stuff after that because I was just so excited after chatting with you all. So I'm graduating this year, but I will still be here for you all. You all have my information. Please feel free to contact me and continue to end your semester and your academic year really strong. I'm very proud and honored to have worked with all of you.
Thanks, Mariella. Jennifer?
Yeah, so just reiterating that, you all did a tremendous job tonight. You should be very, very proud of yourselves. I think even beyond what we're going through, just this is really amazing work. Such diversity in the solutions, even though there are some similarities, which we noticed, but as Cheryl pointed out, but really, really wonderful job. Very impressed. So happy for all the partners and audience and customers and experts that were able to join us tonight. Thank you for that. And just good luck with the rest of your semester. Thank you all.
Thanks, Jennifer. I want to echo all our gratitude to everybody that joined us this evening. You know, we had a number of our speakers dating back to fall 2019, which is ancient history for a lot of people who joined us. You know, folks from FI, Fung Institute, as well as our program, some at-large folks, and of course our partners. We're deeply grateful to all of you, John and Leah from Tin Can, Cheryl from OLLI, Carla and Andrew from SF Tech Council, Cheryl, who am I missing? Fahad from CareMerge. We know it's been a long journey and a tough one with that interruption, let's call it, 5-6 weeks back, almost as we were just getting started, but you stuck with the teams and you stuck with us, and I think the results really speak for themselves. I want to thank my team, Jennifer, our program director, Adrian, our program manager, Ashley Villanueva, who's been in and out between this event and another event this evening, and Mariella, who's been a real partner this whole year in teaching, and who many of you may not know, won the Campus Outstanding GSI Graduate Student Instructor Award last month, which was really well-deserved. And our alumni and our honors fellows that supported this, this cohort. To all of you fellows tonight who went through this year with us, it's really been a year. You know, I'll speak very honestly that you know, we had really good times at boot camp and in the first semester, the start of this semester at our retreat. And, you know, when things went belly up, there were times that I personally wanted to just throw in the towel and say, let's just coast to the end of the year. But the thing that kept pulling me back was all of you, the relationships that we built, the energy that you brought, and understanding that many of you were doing this in really, really tough times, that in spite of, you know, having school go completely digital, having to move for many of you to places really far away, and then having to take on additional work and family responsibilities, you stuck with this. And that is what gave me energy. I think it's what gave all of us energy. And, you know, I'm not trying to put silver lining on something falsely here. I really do think that in some ways, this disruption, as many bad things have come out of it, I think your work is actually stronger for it. And it's about more than the work. It's about the relationships. And like Mariella said, even though we're parting, parting ways now, or in a couple of weeks when everything's submitted and we've done all our assessment. You know, we're still going to be in touch, some of you through the honors program and others of you as alumni. And that's when the really beautiful stuff happens, and we're looking forward to that. So thanks, everyone. We appreciate the time, we appreciate the energy and the positivity, and we're excited to see what comes out of this in terms of next steps. Everybody have a good evening.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye,
everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
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 Jumping on the thank you wagon.
Thank you, Stanley.
Okay, now we can have a team meeting.
No, there's still somebody on.